correct myself on a statement that I've made before. It was not John Wycliffe that said he would make the boy pushing the plow to know more Bible than any pope or bishop. It's William Tyndale. William Tyndale translated the Bible into English in 1520, and that was his purpose, was to bring the Roman Catholic Church to its knees. And the last thing William Tyndale said before the Catholics strangled him and burned him at the stake was, "O Lord God, open the eyes of the King of England." And God answered that prayer about 84 years later, when King James I took the throne of England in 1604, and his first item of business was the Word of God.
Amen.
They call that book the Authorized Version. Now, all the scholars are going to call it the King James Version to make you think it's just one of many versions. It's the Authorized Version. It's authority.
Amen.
It is the final authority of heaven and earth right now.
Amen.
It absolutely, positively rules the world. If I could get on my knees and beg you people, I would, to believe that book above all things.
Amen.
I mean, you go all the way back to the beginning at the Tower of Babel, they're all of one language, ain't they?
Yeah.
What did God do when he come down? He confounded their language. He made it impossible for them to communicate. Mm-hmm. Now you come around and you got something called AT&T, which is global communication, bringing the world together under global communication. God said, "Now let us go down and confound their languages, for the whole world is of one language, and this they try to do. Let us go down and confound their language, for nothing shall what?
Be
impossible to them." So AT&T comes around, and they set out a global communication thing where the whole world can communicate together. And you know what their slogan is? Rethink possible. The book rules the world.
Amen.
If you don't read the Bible, you'll never discern what's right and wrong, what's satanic and what's godly in this world.
Yeah.
You were told in 1 John chapter 4 to try the spirits whether they be of God. And Christians have let many demonic things into their homes, their houses, and their everyday life because they refused to try the spirits to see whether they were of God or not.
That's right.
Amen. Genesis chapter 1, we started last week. We gave an introduction to the book of Genesis. The book of Genesis gives the origin of everything that's still here today.
Amen.
Amen. The United Nations started in Genesis chapter 11. Satan's agenda has not changed. Something you've got to get in your mind, it was God that integrated races. God integrated races. I'm going to go ahead and tell you, everything you were taught from a wee boy up was a lie, and was designed to destroy God's authority and God's word in the earth. You believe that?
Yeah. Segregated.
Yeah, segregated. I'm sorry. God segregated. God segregated the races. So any attempt to integrate them must be of who?
The devil.
There you go. You got it? Now, that Bible says, "Let God be true and every man a
liar."
That's something to live by. Every man is a
liar.
And if he speaks not according to this word, it is because there is no light in him. Isaiah 8:20. This is the final authority. We saw last week how that the book of Genesis shows us the origins of heaven and earth, and the earth was here before the sun. Go ahead and throw the textbooks out. We saw that man was not in a cave like Darwin said he was. He was in a garden.
Right.
Man, through the book of Genesis, is degrading from eternal life to death. Darwin says he's going from death and a monkey to
space.
To progress and eventually achieving eternal life through scientific advancement. Yeah. Amen? We saw the origin of the Tower of Babel and NASA, or the United Nations and NASA. Genesis 11 is the first space program. You got to get it. God even threw Genesis 11 up there so you couldn't miss it, because the first shot that went to the moon supposedly was called Apollo 11. And Apollo is a Greek god who is now in the underworld and is going to come out of the underworld in the last days. That's Greek mythology. Have you never read Revelation 9, 11, that they had a king over them whose name in Greek is Apollyon? Who is he? He's the king of the bottomless pit. So here's NASA laughing in your face. Here we are building a tower whose top may go up to heaven, and right there plastered on the side of that rocket is the name of the king of the bottomless pit. One giant, one small step for man. Baloney, baloney, baloney.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
You can't make it through the 50 chapters of Genesis without God getting you off to a head start in the world around you.
Yeah.
If you read it, pay attention to it. Amen? Now in Genesis 1:1, we're going to start getting into the text. Last week was an introduction. The Bible says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. That is the first God. Look here. You all know this. Cause and effect, right? Everything you see has a cause. Amen? And every cause has an effect. And God is the first cause.
Amen.
The sun, the moon, the stars, the oceans, the animals, mankind, the trees, the plants. Amen? They all were caused by God.
Amen.
John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. You know what God says His name is? Exodus 3:14. What's God's name?
I am.
That is the existence, the eternal life. When Jesus, now listen, God was before space, time, and matter right there in Genesis 1:1.
Right.
Now listen, man, we're going to get out there. We're going to go so far past Darwin and so far past Einstein and Newton and Copernicus, they couldn't catch us traveling at the speed of light in 1 million years, because we've got the most advanced. People say the Bible's not a science book. Well, no duh, stupid. It's the Word of God.
Amen.
People say it's not a history book, but when it speaks of history, it's accurate. It's not like any other book.
Amen.
It's the Word of God. It's true from the beginning, and everything it says endures forever.
Amen.
It is the most advanced science in the world. You can bank on it. Amen? Now Jesus in John 8:58, He says, Abraham rejoiced to see my day. And the Jew says, you ain't even 50 years old yet. You know Abraham? Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am.
That's right.
Now, what did He mean by that stuff? He went from past tense to present tense. Because God exists in the past, present, and future all at one time.
Amen.
That's how He stood outside the reality of time and saw everything that was going to happen before it did happen. And if you read that Bible, He's called prophets into the future.
Yeah.
God. Amen.
Read Revelation 1 with a believing heart sometime in your life.
Amen.
Amen. I, John, was in the Spirit on what day?
The Lord's Day.
The Lord's Day is the second coming of Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus said John wasn't going to die till he saw His coming.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Now listen. God is the I Am, the eternal life, the existence, and by Him all things consist. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life, His life, the life, was the light of men. It's right there in Genesis 1:3.
Right.
Sun, Helios, bunch of sun worshipers. Right there is the light of this world.
Amen.
It is the life of God. You say, well, that's just figurative. Yeah, you better just get on board sometime tonight.
Yeah.
Because that is not a figurative light. When Jesus said, I'm the light of the world, he meant it. When the Bible said the entrance of God's words giveth light, you better believe it. When God spoke to Moses, he shined so bright that they had to put a veil over his face. And if you pay attention to the new birth with a believing heart, you'll see that old man that used to be a drunk all run down. After he gets saved, there's a glow about him. There's a light that has begun to shine in him that one day when he resurrects, he shall shine as the sun in the kingdom of God. Daniel chapter 12. There's the real light. Amen? Science knows nothing about that light. We're going to prove it tonight. Amen? But God is the first cause. He is the beginning of all things. Amen? Now right there it says that he created the heaven and the earth. And that is the only scientific, that is the only true scientific about the origins of heaven and earth. The only true scientific explanation. Now Bill Nye and all them guys will make you think. Go home and watch this tonight on YouTube. Scientism Exposed. It's about an hour and 58 minutes long. You see this book right here? That book's called The Collapse of Evolution. It scientifically disproves evolution using geology, physics, mathematics, biology, and even anthropology. You say, well, it's a pretty small book. That's all it took. That's how dumb of a theory it is. Amen? But they make you think it's been proven. And that book right there absolutely shatters it within about 150 pages.
Yeah.
The only true scientific statement ever made about the origins of heaven and earth is Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
Amen.
You know what the Big Bang says? And I said this last week, and I'll state it again. That in the beginning, there was nothing. Nothing exploded.
Yeah.
That's what it says.
Yeah.
But they say it with fancy terms like, in the beginning, antimatter was overcome by matter. Well, in layman's terms, that was nothing was overcome by something. Amen? Where did the something come from? They still can't find the first cause.
Amen.
Where did the matter come from? First law of thermodynamics says matter cannot be created nor destroyed. So where did it come from? But this nothing became something, and then it exploded, and now you have everything. Charles Darwin came up with the theory of evolution while he was on the island of Galapagos looking at about 14 different species of birds. And you know what he thought? I bet you every one of these birds had a common ancestor. Duh. A bird. But how that means that the bird and the banana are related makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. Amen? Now listen, this is the only true scientific statement that there is on the origins of heaven and earth, and I'm going to prove it. Alright? Now, like I said last week, imagine that I went to a university. I'm kind of summarizing what we went over a little bit last week. But I said last week, imagine I went to a university and went to the science department at Harvard, Yale, any one of them, and I laid down a book like that. And then I laid down a painting, and then I laid down a computer, a bicycle, and a birdhouse, and the scientist said, what are all these things? I said, these things showed up after an explosion in my yard. Could you imagine how stupid he would think I am? But that's what they believe.
Right.
You know you have a greater chance. This is mathematical, folks. It's right here. This is mathematics, absolute mathematical probability. You have a greater chance of taking a monkey, setting him down in front of a typewriter, and teaching it how to just start hitting keys on the typewriter. You have a greater chance that that monkey is accidentally going to write the entire Encyclopedia Britannica on accident than you got of the Big Bang Theory being true.
Amen.
I want you to think about those odds. You know who believes it? 54% of Americans. You know what that means? Americans have lost their ever-loving mind. That's what it means. All right, four possibilities of how heaven and earth got here. Do we have to really explain to you that you're here? Chuck, you're here, right?
Amen.
You showed up. Jamie, you're here. B, you're here. You're here, Billy. Question is, how did we get here? How did we get here? Now, you know what the evolutionists do? They run to the courts, and they mandate that only evolution can be taught in school. I heard Bill Nye, the science guy, say, I don't care if adults neglect or reject evolution for intelligent design, he said, but when they teach it to their kids, that's dangerous. We need them. This is a man that wants to take your kids from you when you're three, when they're 3 and 4 years old, put them in a public school system and make sure that their faith in the Bible and God is destroyed. You know what I think about Bill Nye, the science guy? You want to know what I think about him? I think God's going to break his foolish neck one day. And I think God's going to cast him into a special place in hell for the damage he's done. I believe when God judges that man, he's going to bring up every man that was directly influenced by Bill Nye. Yeah. And say, you destroyed his faith, his faith, his faith, his faith. This one here had a Christian mommy and daddy teaching him the Bible, and he went to school, and you destroyed his faith in the Word of God.
There you go.
I applaud. I can't wait till Bill Nye gets thrown into the lake of fire. I can't wait till Stephen Hawking gets the boot there. I can't wait till Richard Dawkins gets the boot. And I can't wait till Neil deGrasse Tyson gets the boot into the lake of fire. Some of you people looking at me like, I can't believe you would say such a thing. Read Revelation 19. When the whore is thrown into the lake of fire, all the people in heaven cry, hallelujah. And every time they hallelujah, the smoke of her torment rise up. We're feeding the fire.
Amen.
That's amen. What I call it.
Amen.
They're ungodly and they're wicked. Amen. Four possibilities of how you got here. You remember them? School system ain't going to give you all of them. I'll give you all of them. It came from nothing.
It's an illusion.
Came from nothing on accident. It's eternal. That's a possibility. Right? It's always been here. It's not real. That's a possibility. We're all just digesting some bad pizza or something. You think I'm crazy? That's what the Buddhists believe. Mind over matter. That this thing, and they're closer to the truth than what Americans are. The material world is not the truth. In the beginning, God, that's the truth.
Yeah.
The material world is his creation. Amen? You people hear about Jesus walking on the water and they laugh. That's the laws of a higher realm than the physical universe.
Yeah.
Amen? Now, another possibility is it came from nothing. Supernaturally or intelligently. There are no other possibilities.
Check the spell. On the
four.
On four?
Yeah.
F-O-R.
Oh. Don't worry about that stuff. Now look.
Somebody watches my.
It's either not real. It's either not here. Okay, that's one possibility. How many of you want to take that road?
No.
Okay, then it's here, right?
Yeah.
Now you're only left with two possibilities. It's either always been here, or there was a time when it wasn't here and it showed up. And if it came from nothing, it was either a big accident, random rolling of the dice, or something creative. Can you think of another possibility? Now you see this one right here? You know what that is? That's a violation. A violation of the first law of thermodynamics. Proven science. It's right here. Any of you can go home and look this stuff up. What is the first law of thermodynamics? Matter cannot be created nor destroyed. Energy cannot be created nor destroyed. It can only be transferred or transformed. Amen. What happens to wood when you burn it?
Transformed.
Into what?
Smoke.
Ashes.
Ash.
All matter on this earth has three states it can exist in. Solid, liquid, gas. You take water and you heat it up, it turns into vapor. But that vapor can be turned back into water. You can never destroy the water. You got it? Matter cannot be created and it cannot be destroyed. Well, then it must be eternal. If it can't be created or destroyed, it must have always been here. No violation of the second law of thermodynamics. God's done busted you right upside the head with just two simple laws back to back. He said it can't be created or destroyed and it can't be eternal. Therefore, it must be an illusion or it's me. No wonder the Bible said the fool has said in his heart there is no God. You know what the second law of thermodynamics is? It's called the law of energy decay. And it has basically, I'm just going to look at two applications of it. Two applications of this law. It's number one, the energy available for useful work in a functioning system tends to decrease, even though the total energy remains constant. You can't get rid of the energy, but once it's been used for work, you can't use it again. Now, I ate. My body metabolized it, turned it into energy. I just put that energy into the door. How am I going to get it back? It's there now. Now, sometimes we can recapture that energy by putting a spring right here. And when we let go of that door, the energy trapped in the spring will shut it back. But how are you going to get it back now? Once you use energy, you cannot get it back. That means in the beginning, when God created, there was the total amount of available energy. And from over the passing of time, this total amount is still there, but it's no longer useful. It's no longer useful. You take gasoline. I showed you this last week. You take gasoline, you put it in a car. We use a piston to create heat. Or we use a spark plug to create heat. We inject that gasoline into the engine. It combusts. That creates heat energy. That heat expands the air, and we use that heat to force a piston down. It's the same way a gun operates. Right? We use the energy of that's in gunpowder to project a bullet out of a gun. We use that piston goes down, and that up and down motion of the piston is converted into circular motion through the crankshaft out the transmission into the tires. Most of the energy in the gasoline goes out the exhaust, out the radiator, and what we use as motion turns back in the heat when we press the brakes. And then brakes start slowing that tire down. We're taking that kinetic energy and turning it back into heat energy. It goes out in the atmosphere. How are you going to get it back? It's no longer useful. It's still there. It's not useful. That means sometime in the near future, the world's going to run out of useful energy. Maybe not near future. God's got a plan. It's called the reversal of Eden. The second law of thermodynamics is a result of Adam's fall. We're going to see that. The second application of this law is that the organized complexity of a structural system tends to become disorganized and random. That means the second law of thermodynamics states that it goes from order to disorder, not disorder to order. It characterizes everything on earth.
Amen.
What happens to your car in about 10 years?
Breaks down.
It rusts. What happens to a tree? It dies, falls over, and rots. You can prove this anywhere on planet Earth. It is a law that evolutionists don't want to discuss. They don't want to discuss it. You know what Sir Arthur Eddington said? He said, any theory of the universe that does not, let me find it here, thank you. Yeah, here it is. Listen to what he says. If your theory is found to be against the second law of thermodynamics, I can give you no hope. There is nothing for it but to collapse in deepest humiliation. Another English scientist from England around the late 1800s, early 1900s, when Darwin was first coming around, he said, I believe that evolution will be one of the biggest jokes ever penned in a scientific textbook in the future. And it already has been, but they keep teaching the lie. You know how many times evolution's been proved wrong? The second law of thermodynamics states that it cannot be eternal. It goes from order to disorder. You got that. It characterizes everything on earth. Darwin taught that we're going from disorder and chaos to order. The Bible teaches that we're going from order to disorder. Which one backs up proven science? God created it and saw that it was all good. Man's living. Well, first he had eternal life. Then he's cast out of the garden. Can no longer eat the tree, which keeps the second law of thermodynamics in check, keeps restored. Now, I told you it's the most advanced science book in the world.
Yeah.
Then leaves of that tree are used for the healing of the nations in Revelation 22.
Right.
But when Adam sinned and got kicked out of the garden, what happened? He lived 930 years. One man lived 777 years. One man lived 969 years. After the flood, what happens? Noah was 600 years old when he went on the ark. He comes off, he dies about 850. His sons live up to their 500 and 600s. By the time you get to Abraham, they're living in their 200s. And by the time you get to Exodus, they're 120 years old. And by the time Moses penned Psalm chapter 90, a man's days is expected to be 70 years on the earth. Where's it going from? Order to disorder or disorder to order?
Order to disorder.
Which one's biblical? Which one's scientific, the Bible or Darwin?
The Bible.
You can kindly stick a boot up Darwin's rear end at this point. Darwinism and evolution is not an attack on creation. And this is what you people need to understand. Darwinism is an attack of the work of Jesus Christ on Calvary.
Amen.
Yeah.
For if there is no Garden of Eden and a fall, there is no need for Calvary.
Amen.
If man is progressing, there's no need for Calvary. If he's degrading, Calvary becomes an essential element of this world that must be taught to mankind.
Amen.
It's an attack on the cross of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Henry Morris writes this. Let me read you this one, and then we'll move into verse 2. Listen very carefully. Listen, man, it's going to get weird tonight. Y'all keep up. The second law proves, as certainly as science can prove anything whatever, that the universe had a beginning. Similarly, the first law shows that the universe could not have begun itself. The first law of thermodynamics says the universe could not have begun itself. The total quantity of energy in the universe is a constant, but the quantity of available energy is decreasing. Therefore, as we go backward in time, the available energy would have been progressively greater until finally we would reach the beginning point where available energy equaled total energy. Time could go back no further than this. At this point, both energy and time must have come into existence. Since energy cannot create itself, the most scientific and logical conclusion to which we could possibly come is that in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
Amen.
It's scientific. That verse right there is scientific. It's the only true science. Alright? You know what we just did? We just marked these two possibilities out. I'm going to sit up here and talk about transitional species and talk about endless genealogies and all these theories. Right there are the possibilities. Two of them are unscientific. Right off the bat. Now you're in a pickle. You're either going to the nut house or the church.
You choose.
You choose. Amen?
Amen.
Now imagine them sending your kids to school and teaching them Darwinism when it can be proved wrong in about 15 minutes. And it's not just physics. Mathematics, biology, geology, the fossil records, anthropology, it all proves Darwin wrong.
Yeah. Yep, it does.
And they know it's wrong. That's why they don't want the Bible taught beside it in the school system.
That's exactly right.
They're scared of playing the fool.
Yeah.
Amen. You say, but isn't Genesis 1:1? Nothing. I mean, the universe can't be created. Matter can't be created or destroyed. Right? Can't be eternal, so then isn't Genesis 1:1 a violation of the first law? No, and the eternal God is not a violation of the second law. In the beginning, God created time, space, and matter, and He wrote the laws. Mm-hmm. The easiest way I can explain it is Bill Gates writes a law that governs Microsoft Word, and it says, Mississippi can only be spelled like this. And so when you try to spell Mississippi any other way, it'll either underline it or autocorrect it or something like that. But that don't keep Bill Gates from spelling it any way he wants to on a piece of paper.
Amen.
He's not governed by the laws he wrote. God is not governed by the laws he wrote. God is a spirit. The laws of thermodynamics govern the material world, not a spirit.
Amen.
Got it? The only true science is God. We're off to a good start, ain't we?
Yeah.
Amen? Don't be scared of some stuffed shirt with a PhD. You read that book and you'll make him just look as stupid as a rock anytime you want to. He's a monkey man. Amen? We're children of God. They're monkey men. They don't stand a chance. Amen? Now, this is where the Bible begins. Begins with the most advanced science known to man. As a child of God, you know the origins of the universe.
Yeah. Amen.
You know their origins, their beginnings. Amen. We're off to a flying start. And buddy, just wait till we get to the scientific revelations from about verse 2 down to verse 10. It's about to get deep. Amen. They can't catch us. Alright? This heaven and earth is God's first revelation to man.
Yeah.
Get Romans, Jamie, you get Romans 1, Dad, you get Psalm 19. We're going to make people read the Bible. Might be the only time they read it this week. I'm not saying that about you two either. Don't get offended. Jamie, Romans 1:20, read it. Read Romans 1:18 through 20. Dad, you get Psalm 19, 1 through 6. I'm getting ready to teach you one of the most important truths you've got to learn. Something you've got to learn real quick. Romans 1:18 through 20.
For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse.
These men hold a truth. They possess a truth. That's what it said. What is it? A knowledge that God has given them.
Yeah.
What is the knowledge that He's given them? His power and Godhead displayed in the creation.
Yeah.
And they're without excuse. Psalm 19, beginning in verse 1.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth His handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, night unto night showeth knowledge.
Right there. That means creation is on equal par with the King James Bible. It speaks.
Amen.
Keep reading.
There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world.
All right, that's good. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth His handiwork. Now, what do you even know about the firmament? Not a daggone thing.
Yep.
The Egyptians knew about it. And the ancient Hebrews knew about it, and the Mayans knew about it, and the Chinese astronomers knew about it. But you don't know anything about the firmament. And it's a main subject in that Bible from Genesis chapter 1 to Revelation chapter 22. It shows you something. Day unto day, every day that man wakes his foolish head up off of the bed, the day is speaking. It uttereth speech. One of the things the day speaks of is the two comings of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Evening and morning. Night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no language nor speech where their voice is not heard. Every day and every night is speaking to every Mexican, black, white, Italian, Polish, Chinaman, whatever language you speak, the creation is speaking to you about God's glory and His handiwork.
Amen.
Right.
That is, creation is the first revelation God gives to every single man and woman on the face of the earth.
Yeah. That's right.
And if you go through this world and say there is no God, you're the biggest fool that ever walked the earth. Psalm 14 and 1.
Yeah.
The fool have said in his heart, there is no God.
Yeah.
But now I'm going to teach you an important truth. You better get it. If you don't get it, you're going to get your throat slit wide open.
By the sword.
Genesis chapter 2. Little Paul, Genesis chapter 2. I know this will be the only Bible you've read this week. Genesis 2, 16 through 17. And then go to Genesis 3, 1 through 5.
You too, Jacob.
Listen, I'm not preaching. We're going to teach Bible tonight. We're going to have to flip through the Bible and see what the Bible says. People's like, the Bible teaches, the Bible teaches. How do you know what it teaches if you don't know what it says?
Amen.
I mean, you people actually probably believe the Bible says that you're on a spinning ball hurling through space at over 400 million miles an hour. Well, it don't. You know who told you that? NASA. The same people naming their spacecraft after the king of the bottomless pit, that who you want to follow in life?
No.
And we already seen the Bible was right in Genesis 1:1. It made a statement in 1689 B.C. that's still true and proven today.
Amen.
I guarantee you whatever it says after that's going to be true too. David said, thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. Genesis 2, 16 through 17, God said something.
And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die.
So God said something, right? Look in Genesis 3, 1 now, little Paul. I'll read it. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made, and he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? The first positive thing spoken in that Bible is by Satan. Yea. Yes. Like, yes we can, or yes we will, or something to that effect. You know what God was doing prior to this? He was dividing stuff.
Yeah. Amen.
He was separating things and saying the apple's going to bring forth an apple and the orange is going to bring forth an orange. This is dark, that's light. They're not the same. The light is good, the darkness is bad. This is the dry land. He was dividing. Amen?
Yeah.
Satan shows up after God spoke and said, hath God said? Right? Then what's he do in verse 5? After he sees that his subtle attack, that's how Satan is, man. 1500 A.D., he comes up with heliocentric. And the whole time he's setting you up to print you monkey men in the 1900s. And Christians in the 1500s laid down their biblical account of creation.
Yes.
And started picking up heliocentric models. The earth is not at the center. And the sun doesn't go around us. We go around the sun. It's no big mistake. Maybe them old writers of the Bible just spoke. Let me tell you something. If they're writing according to their own understanding, you can't believe what they say about your salvation either.
That's right.
That is not a book of man's wisdom.
Amen.
And we laid it down, and then before you know it, they come out in the 1800s. And the origin of species. And the Big Bang. And all this stuff. And Christians just kept getting beat down and beat down and beat down. None of them believe the Bible anymore. Satan simply come and tested the waters. Yes, hath God said that you should not eat of every tree? What did Eve do? Yeah, he said that we can't, that we can eat of every tree in the garden. She subtracted from the word of God right there. Then she said, but of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, we shall not eat nor touch it. She added to the word of God. And then she said, lest we die, she softened the blow. She gave a different rendering. That's the NIV version right there, you know. God said, you shall surely die. She said, lest we die. That's the original Hebrew. That's what, it, you know, a different translation or a better translation would be. She's the first Bible reviser in the Scriptures.
Amen.
What Satan do? He realized he's got her by the throat right
now. Amen.
She didn't believe the book. She didn't believe the word of God. And Satan's got her right there by the throat, and he looks at her and he says, you shall not surely die.
Yeah.
There's the lie.
Yes.
Amen.
And he didn't have to say anything other than question. Once he gets you questioning that book, then comes the lies. All he's got to do, first of all, is get you to question whether it's the earth moving or the sun. And once he got you believing that, he started just stuffing it down your throat every day, all day, for the last 500 years.
That's right.
And now man looks at the Bible as the most mythological book of myths and jokes and comic book stories that the world's ever known.
Yep, that's right.
Come to Matthew chapter 3. That's the first time Satan speaks in the Old Testament. Did you get it? I'm going somewhere with this, folks. You bear with me. Matthew chapter 3, verse 17. Jesus just got baptized. In verse 17, there was a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. God said something there. Jump down. 4:3. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God. Well, it's almost like every time God speaks, up pops the devil.
Yeah.
Did you learn it? Did you learn that great important lesson in the Bible? The first time God said anything in the Old Testament, Satan showed up and said, did God say? First time God said anything in the New Testament, this is my beloved Son, Satan shows up and says, if thou be the Son of God. Now what's the first thing God really said? 2 Peter 3:5, by the word of God, the heavens were of old. Hebrews 11:3, we understand by faith that the worlds were framed by the word of God. God said, let there be light, and there was light. God said, let there be a firmament. The first thing God ever spoke was the creation. Now, what should you expect from Satan?
To question it.
Cast doubts.
Cast doubts. Question it. Lie about it.
Amen.
Why do you believe these people? Why do you believe NASA? Just why do you do it? You people walk around acting like you know something about the universe. And ain't one of you even own a telescope. Get over yourself. You act like you've got this knowledge that you've earned. It's all been, you've been told what to think from the time you were this big.
Amen. That's
you better get in the book and unlearn it.
Amen.
Satan is a liar.
Amen.
From the beginning and the father of it.
Amen.
That Bible said he deceiveth the whole world. Revelation 12:9. Yeah. Do not underestimate his deception.
Amen.
When the Bible said he deceived the whole world, it meant he deceived the whole world.
Yes.
Amen. And you know what the problem is? As I start telling you what the Bible says, I've worked with Christians that laugh at me at what I believe. You know what I do? I just look at them and say, you can always tell when a Christian ain't reading their Bible. And watch the Holy Spirit just poke them and say, he's telling the truth. Their heart drops. Laugh at me, man. I'm rooted. I'm fixed. My head's as hard as a flint, man. I'm on a sure footing and a sure foundation.
It is hard.
If any man heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, he shall be like unto a wise man that built his house upon the rock.
Amen.
And the storms came and the winds blew and the house stood.
Amen.
You ain't gonna move me, man. I'm immovable.
Yep.
What's wrong with Christians joining hands with science to make fun of other Christians?
Amen.
Isn't that strange business going on today?
Amen.
You know what the influence is behind it? Satan. You know who Satan gives his power to? It's in the Bible. Luke chapter 4, he offered it to Jesus Christ. What was the condition? He showed him all the kingdoms of the world and said, all this will I give you if you fall down and worship me, for these are mine and I give them to who I will. So then who's the right hands of Satan? Government agencies.
Amen.
Yeah.
NASA. See, I'm sorry I'm bringing the Bible up to the real world for you. The CIA, the FBI.
Yeah.
Democrats and Republicans.
Yeah.
Amen.
The Federal Reserve Bank.
Amen.
Congressmen and senators.
Amen.
State legislators. Lawyers.
Amen.
Yeah.
Deceiving and being deceived.
Amen, amen, amen. Who's propagating his lies? NASA. I mean, and now they're just laughing in your face about it. Supposedly they had a satellite go out past Pluto. You know, it left in, 1968 or something. It made it, I don't know what year it left. I don't care. I don't believe it.
Yeah.
And they went out there and supposedly got these close-up pictures of Pluto. I love it when NASA puts these pictures out where it's taking a picture of the satellite passing by. I guess they sent up another, just a special photography satellite behind it to capture the pictures as it passed by. And then they put out a picture of the moon landing showing the lunar module coming down.
Yeah.
Well, I guess Neil Armstrong wasn't the first man to make walk on the moon. The film crew was there before him. Amen? And then they send this picture back to Pluto, and right there in the... You'll have to go home and look it up. But right there in the picture, I can't draw, is Pluto from the Disney cartoons. And they're sitting there going, man, if they believe this, they'll believe anything, won't they? Every picture they've ever took from Earth is a computer-generated image. You can go home and look them up. One of these satellites supposedly went out so far and turned around and showed Earth and its spin. But they made a fatal flaw. It was supposed to be a 24-hour picture where it showed the rotation of the Earth. And you know what they messed up on? Not one cloud changed. 24 hours? I'm going outside and watch them change in 5 seconds.
Yeah.
And that Earth sitting there spinning and the clouds are sitting there saying, just sitting still. Yeah. You believe that stuff. And a tried, tested, proven book don't even get touched or read.
Right, right.
Satan lies to you about where you live. Why? Because it declares God's glory.
Amen.
It shows his handiwork.
Amen.
Therefore, he lies about it and deceives about it. Amen. You say, you don't think we've been to the moon? I know we haven't been to the moon. Obama recently admitted it, if you pay attention. He said, in the near future, we're going to strengthen science once more. And we're going to figure out how to get past the Van Allen radiation belts so that man can finally leave low Earth orbit and travel into space, possibly to the moon. This was what he said.
Oh, my.
He just acknowledged that we've not been outside of low Earth orbit. Well, you didn't need Obama to tell you. Jesus Christ told you that in John chapter 3. No man hath ascended up into heaven, but the Son of Man which came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. Satan said, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will exalt my throne. I will ascend into the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Wow, there's some advanced science there. What did God say? Yet thou shalt be brought down.
Right.
There's a law. There's a law created by God. What goes up must come down.
Yeah.
And what goes down must go up.
Amen.
That's true laws of physics right there.
Amen.
higher than anything Newton ever wrote. What did Jesus Christ do? He went down on his face and said, not my will but thine be done. And God said, get up here to my right hand.
Amen.
Satan said, I'm going to exalt myself up there. God said, then thou shalt be brought down to the sides of the pit.
Amen.
And all that see thee shall shake their head at thee and say, are thou him that did weaken the nations?
Amen.
Weaken the nations.
Yeah.
Why do you believe in accident?
Well, God stopped the sun and backed it up. He didn't stop the earth and backed it up.
We'll get to that, Chuck. But the truth of the matter is why should I venture off into teaching the Bible until I first establish its authority and its enemy?
Yeah.
It is the authority.
Amen.
That's why the courts want nothing to do with it. That's why the school system wants nothing to do with it. That's why the universities want nothing to do with it. That's why the governments want nothing to do with it. NASA wants nothing to do with it. The science books want nothing to do with it. And most churches want nothing to do with it. Why? Quite simply because man is in a fallen, rebellious state.
Amen.
That's right.
It is the authority.
Amen.
And it's got a real enemy in this world.
Yeah.
And that enemy started from the time you were born. Listen to me. He's already put things in your head. Yep. Through television, education, Satan has attacked every word of God from Genesis to Revelation 22 in your mind before you ever opened that book for the first time.
That's the truth, Paul.
Most of you's going to laugh at what I've got to say tonight when we get to it. I'm fine. Laugh away, man. Laugh away. I don't care. Public opinion is not the authority.
Amen.
Science is not the authority. Most of them's dead and gone. I mean, if you want to listen to a man who's been dead for 400 years, go right ahead. The man I'm listening to is not here, for he is risen as he said.
Amen.
You gotta get it, man. This book is true from cover to cover. And whatever's contrary to it, you can just disregard.
That's right.
I don't care if it's a preacher or whoever.
Amen.
You can disregard. That Bible said, he that cometh to God must first believe that he is. And he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. We've established that he is, Genesis 1:1. Now we're going to diligently seek him in the Scripture.